Did you know that calories have not even been around that long? The calorie, which is simply a measurement of energy, was created in the late 1880s, and then in 1990, the FDA started to require calories to be on labels of foods. And so today we're going to talk about what even is a calorie, how is it determined, and is it even helpful? I'm Ashley Oswald, dietitian and founder of Oswald Digestive Clinic, where we help people improve and eliminate bothersome gut issues like gas, bloat, diarrhea, and or constipation. You can work with us one of two ways. You can book a free 30-minute gut health call below to work one-on-one and create a personalized nutrition plan with you to help relieve your bothersome symptoms, or you can join us in our Heal Your Gut course. Link is also below. So without further ado, let's dive in and talk about calories. So a calorie is simply a unit of measure. It's not an exact science like we're going to get into, but basically a calorie is equal to the amount of heat needed to raise 1 milliliter, which is also the same as 1 gram of water, by 1 degree Celsius. At standard atmospheric pressure. So what does that mean in other words? It's simply the volume of water times the change in temperature is a calorie. I know that still sounds confusing, so let me bring up an image to help explain this a little bit better. So here you'll see this thing called the bomb calorimeter, and this is how calories initially were determined. And I want to start off by saying that a food calorie is actually a kilocalorie. We say calorie to simplify it, but in other words, a food calorie is the amount of energy needed to raise a temperature of 1 liter of water by 1 degree. So 1 kilocalorie equals 1,000 calories. I know this is probably still confusing, so let's talk about this bomb calorimeter now. So you can see in the image, what happens originally, the first system was that they would place food in the sealed container. The water content of the food was evaporated. They put it in the sealed container. They'd surround it by a known amount of water. And that's important because, again, that you need to know the volume of water to multiply it by the change in temperature to get the calories. And then they put they'd seal the container. Oxygen is piped in, the food is ignited using electricity, so in other words, set on fire, and then the result is when the calorie is found from that rise in water temperature as the food basically burns down as much as it can burn down. So for example, if the temperature of the water goes up 1 degree per kilogram of water, the food has 1 calorie. 2 degrees, 2 calories. And 235 degrees, 235 calories, which they also would call an 8 ounce or 1 cup chocolate milk. Now, as you can see, do you think our bodies work this way exactly? No, our bodies are so complex. So I want to tell you though about the second system that was created after this one that they felt was a little more accurate as far as determining calories. But then I also want to share after that some still limitations of the second system. So the second system is called the at water system, or it's called the 494 system. So this system was created because the bomb calorimeter system didn't take into account that humans, we lose some calories through heat, through urine, through feces. So in the bomb calorimeter, for example, fiber would get burnt out and contributed to those calories, but in the human body, a lot of fibers pass right through. And it's a step more complex than that because it's estimated that some fiber can be eaten by the bacteria in our large intestine and could contribute up to 10% of our calories from this process of the bacteria fermenting that fiber and creating short-chain fatty acids from it. So one example of how it's not so black and white as far as how metabolism works in the body. So this Atwater system was developed by U.S. chemist Wilbur Atwater in the late 19th to 20th centuries. And he worked and wanted to correct for these things that the bomb calorimeter wasn't taking into consideration. So what Wilbur Atwater did was he basically used the bomb calorimeter to figure out how many calories these people were eating in their food, but then he also measured the amount they were excreting in their urine and in their stool. And then he was able to subtract that to try to figure out how much they were absorbing. And what he came to realize is he determined that there is a standard reference tables when you kind of round things off. So the 494 system comes from him finding out that there is about 4 calories per gram of carbohydrate, 9 calories per gram of fat, and 4 calories per gram of protein. Now, again, it's rounded because every food is a little different. And then there is 3 calories per gram for organic acids, and then 7 for alcohols. And so this is where now in standard kind of dietetics, we kind of pull those numbers from and then can kind of calculate out different percentages for different things. But it's still not a perfect science. So in 2012, a study came out from the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition that found the energy content of certain foods, like in specific nuts, were not being accurately calculated. Now, there's a lot of different factors that go into it, but it goes back to what I mentioned. Our bodies aren't simply this very simple kind of burn mechanism. It's really complex, and everybody's gut system is working slightly different as far as absorption goes. And so in this study, they found that in nuts, they actually contained 129 calories versus what using that Atwater system showed, they would have 168 to 170 calories. So just one example, and that's about a 32% overestimation. Now the FDA knows this, and the FDA actually allows for a 20% difference in the calories that are put on a food's label because they realize it's not a perfect science. So what does that mean in more simple terms? If you go and buy a food at the store, and if you're really into calorie count, you're trying to get one, like 1500 calories a day, 2000 calories a day, maybe you're a really competitive athlete shooting for like 5000 calories a day, and you're going down to the T of reading the labels, what you need to know is actually that calorie number on the label, it could vary about 20% as far as what the actual kind of calorie amount is of that food. So it can be something, it can be like a very simple guidance tool, but our bodies are so much more complex than just calories in, calories out, and I want to share a bit about that with you today and what you might consider doing instead of counting calories. So what I would recommend instead is really learning and honing into intuitive eating approaches and looking at the quality of food over the quantity. In other words, the nutrient density of foods. And why this can be helpful is that there's a lot of factors that go into our calorie needs, and it's not the same thing every single day. So women, as they're going through their hormone cycle, some weeks they have higher calorie needs than other weeks. Depending upon somebody's age and activity for a day or week, it's gonna change. It's gonna change based upon gender, based upon whether you're pregnant or nursing, or you know, all sorts of different things, how much muscle mass you have, which can change month to month depending upon what types of activity you're doing. So it can really throw you in this whiplash pattern if you're going through life trying to figure out how many calories you need to eat every day, especially with the limitations of that Atwater calorie system. So looking at intuitive eating approaches and quality of food is going to be so much more effective for most people. Now, what do I even mean by that? So what I mean is, for example, most people will count calories because they want to lose weight. Well, did you know that multiple studies have looked at overly processed food for weight, and they found that individuals that were allowed to eat as much as they wanted, the individuals who ate the less processed food, more whole real foods, they actually lost weight even though they were allowed to eat as much as they wanted. On the other hand, people who were able to have the more processed kind of calorie nutrient dense not nutrient dense, but calorie dense foods, possibly micronutrient poor, they actually gained weight during that same period, even though there is no limitations to the amount of food for either group. So that's one example. Food is really information, and if we're simply counting calories, you're losing out on that whole kind of world of how we use food as information. Why is it important to get a variety of whole real foods and all these micronutrients like vitamins and minerals and phytonutrients and antioxidants? And if you're just counting calories, eating foods that are poor in those things, it could really be negatively impacting A, your ability to lose weight, but it's not all about weight, it's about all over body health, because it really all goes hand in hand. Now, hunter-gatherer diets, you know, as I mentioned, the calorie was first created in the late 1800s, and it was started to be labeled in 1900. So obviously before then, we didn't even look at any of this, and people were really pretty healthy. The Inuit, they ate mostly meat and fish, small amounts of fruits and vegetables. The Kiwi in South America, Amazon, they ate about the same, but added in some roots. And then Kung in South Africa ate lots of seeds and nuts, 20% fruits and veggies, 10% meat and fish. And the Hadza in Africa ate about 50% meat and fish and the rest fruit, veggies, roots. So those are some examples of this whole real unprocessed type of food eating. Eat when you're hungry, stop when you're satisfied, about 80% full, as I like to say. The Japanese even have a saying called hara hachibu, meaning eat until 80% full. And there's all sorts of kind of tools that we include in our Heal Your Gut course if you want to learn more about what we're talking about here. And now I want to share one more thing. It was a public health study in March of 2014 at the Yale School of Public Health and School of Medicine, where they looked at all these different diets. So you have low carb, low fat, vegetarian, vegan, low glycemic, Mediterranean, mixed balance, paleo. And there's health benefits related to all of those. But the thing that they found that all these eating practices had in common is that eat food, not too much, mostly plants. It's really simple, right? And I really encourage kind of thinking of food and eating that way versus hyper-focusing on calorie content, which can not even only throw you in a health roller coaster, but can throw you in an emotional roller coaster as well. So think about, what did your grandparents eat? They ended it by saying, a diet of minimally processed foods close to nature, predominantly plants, is decisively associated with health promotion and disease prevention. So kind of foundational level. So let's just wrap this up here. Calories are determined. First, they were using the bomb calorimeter technique, and then they developed the Atwater technique. And do I recommend counting calories? Very, very rarely. There are instances where it can be really helpful. Like if you're working in an intensive care unit situation and somebody's on like a breathing machine right after a trauma, you know, we need some way to kind of estimate how much food that they need, because they can't do these other practices that we're talking about. They're needing to be fed through a tube. And there's other examples like that. And even if somebody is just really out of tune with their natural kind of intuitive eating mechanisms, maybe we use calorie counting as like a guidance system. But ultimately, I would really discourage kind of thinking of calories, and I would encourage honing into intuitive eating principles, which in our Heal Your Gut course, we have a whole section on this where you can learn tools and techniques. And then also think more about eating real whole plant-based foods. So I hope this was helpful for you and interesting. Please subscribe if you haven't. Hit the bell next to the subscribe button so you get notified of new videos that we release every Tuesday at 10 a.m. Central Time. And I thank you for watching. I hope you're having a great day, and I will see you next week, Tuesday at 10 a.m. Central Time. All right, bye.